We cannot afford to sit back and just let Passover and the days of unleavened bread to just all of a sudden pop upon us. We need to be thinking right now and planning right now for these days that are right directly in front of us. And as I said, nothing's more important in our life right now than the days that are coming up, which are God's feast days. These days require us to be mentally prepared, focused, with our mind completely dwelling upon their value to us in our life and the meaning that they have to us in our life. So in my sermon today, I would like to set our focus for the coming spring Holy Day season. With a proper focus, we will come through these days being spiritually inspired, and our relationship with God will be rejuvenated. And I think that's what we all hope for. That's what God hopes for us. That as we go through His feast days, that we'll come out of them on the other side being rejuvenated in our relationship with God and with Jesus Christ. But it, as I mentioned, it does require us to be focused. It requires us to give thought and contemplation about the meaning of these days. Thought and contemplation about our relationship with God and with Jesus Christ. So I have 3 points for us today on how we can best focus our mind heading into the spring Holy Day season. The title for my sermon today is Preparing for the Spring Feast Days. Preparing for the Spring Feast Days. My first point today is examine yourself. Examine yourself. The first of God's feast days is the Passover. It's not a holy day, but it is listed in His feast days, and you can see that for yourself in Leviticus chapter 23. Turn with me, if you would, to 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 28. A passage that we're all very familiar with. Paul tells us in this passage that as Passover nears, we're instructed to examine ourselves, to take a look at ourselves. 1 Corinthians 11, verse 28. Paul says, "But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup." Now, he's not talking about our regular dinner meal here. He's talking about and referring to the Passover service, to partaking of the bread that Jesus Christ offers us, and also of His blood that He offers us. He said, "But first, we are to examine ourselves, to consider our relationship with God and with Jesus Christ, to consider how we're doing in our life and in our relationship with God and with Jesus Christ." Most of us, I think, that live our life as Christ lived His, focus on our lives all the time. But this is a moment in time right before Passover where we really need to look at our lives. Really need to focus in and ask ourselves, am I an authentic Christian? There's an interesting information behind the term examine in 1 Corinthians 11, verse 28. But the Greek word for examine is dokimizo. Dokimizo. I'll spell that for you if you'd like. It's D-O-K-I-M-A-Z-O, and it's pronounced dokimizo. It means to test or to prove or to prove to be authentic. In the Blue Letter Bible website, blueletterbible.org, it has a footnote in regards to this Greek word dokimizo. It says, "In the ancient world, there was no banking system as we know it today, and no paper money. So all their money was made out of metal. It was coin. All money was made from metal, heated until liquid, poured into molds, and allowed to cool. When the coins were cooled, it was necessary to smooth off the uneven edges. The coins were comparatively soft, and of course, many people shaved them closely. In one century, more than 80 laws were passed in Athens to stop the practice of whittling down the coins that were then in circulation. And I was trying to do some research to find out what would be the advantage of whittling down the coin. Because if you do it by weights, I would think it would be more valuable if it was heavy. But the only thing I could come up with, and this is my own assumption, that I may be off base, but I would think that metal was quite difficult to come by in the time of Jesus Christ. So that if you had coins and you could take your knife and whittle down the outside edge of it, eventually you'd have a little pile of metal shavings. And if you do that enough, I imagine you'd have enough to heat up and to make your own counterfeit coin. So that's my own logic there, but I may be wrong. There has to be some benefit to whittling down the metal or shaving off that metal. And of course, if you shave it off, you have more metal, which I don't think they had Ace hardware stores back in the time of Jesus Christ. But some money changers were men of integrity. I'll read that again. Some money changers were men of integrity who would accept no counterfeit money. They were men of honor who put only genuine, full-weighted money into circulation. These men had a name. What do you think that was? Dokimizos. They were examiners of the money. They actually called them Dokimizos, because they were the examiners of the money. And they only put authentic coins into circulation. They were very careful about that. These men would make sure that the coins were absolutely authentic and not a cheapened version of the real thing. We need to have that same focus in our life as we get close to the Passover. We need to make sure that we're a real Christian, all the way through to our heart. We need to be a person that just doesn't sound like a Christian or look like a Christian. This world is full of fake or imitation followers of Jesus Christ. Turn with me, if you would, to Matthew 23, verses 27 and 28. Jesus Christ addressed this very same subject. And we're very familiar with this. He was talking to the scribes and the Pharisees. Verse 27, he says, "Woe to you." That's kind of like saying, I wouldn't want to be in your shoes. "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you are like whitewashed tombs, which indeed appear beautiful outwardly, but inside are full of dead men's bones and all uncleanness." You see, Jesus Christ wasn't impressed with the outward appearance and look or the sound of the scribes and the Pharisees. It didn't matter to him if they sounded religious, if they could quote scripture after scripture after scripture. Christ is focused on what you're doing and the work that's being done in your heart. Are you a man or a woman that is changing and working and growing and constantly examining yourself and your actions and your thoughts and your motivations? That's a real Christian. A real Christian is constantly examining himself, making sure that he's walking as close as possible to the example set by Jesus Christ. And that's a hard thing to do. Jesus Christ has some big shoes to fill. But we don't do it alone. As we know, we do it with Jesus Christ and with the Holy Spirit guiding us and directing us and helping us along the way. Going on, Jesus Christ said in verse 28, "Even so, you also outwardly appear righteous to men, but inside you are full of hypocrisy and lawlessness." We got to make sure that that's not us. We have to make sure that we are authentic all the way down to our heart, genuine followers of Jesus Christ. We need to make sure that we don't just look like Christians because we keep the Sabbath. We don't just look like Christians because we don't eat pork. We don't just look like Christians because we pay our tithes. We need to make sure that there is a work going on inside of us. We need to examine our work and know that it's not just our work, but it's the work of Jesus Christ. But we have to yield to Him. We have to yield to His Holy Spirit working in our mind and our life, giving us the guidance to walk in the way of Jesus Christ. God the Father and Jesus Christ know our heart. And we must also know our heart. We shouldn't sit back and deceive ourselves and say, well, you know, I'm a pretty good Christian. That's not the focus that we should have. We need to find those weak spots, the places that still need a little more work in our life. Prior to baptism, we should have done this same type of examination where we look at ourselves and we look at our motivations in our life. And we should have seen the filthiness of sin in our life. We need to see it. Sin is in each and every one of us. It was in Paul. He was distraught over, and you read Romans chapter 7, he was distraught and frustrated about the sin that he saw in his own life. And yet at the end of Romans chapter 7, what did he say? He said that he had give thanks because he had the hope that Jesus Christ was more powerful than the sin that is in his life. He could see that work that Jesus Christ was doing in his life. Some of the sins that we've struggled with our entire life may still be there. But we need to look through our life and see if they're still there and work to overcoming them. It's a tough thing. I know in my own personal baptism counseling, the minister that counseled me, he told me, he said, Bart, he said, sin will always be with us. Some of the sins that you experience now may continue with you for years, but our focus is to work to overcome them, work to grow and change and not be accepting of them. And that's really the dangerous part in our life, is because some sins can end up being there for so long, we just accept it into our life. Every one of us, because we live in a world filled with sin, accept some level of sin around us as okay. But God and Jesus Christ don't accept any sin. They're very sensitive to sin around them. And they don't accept it. They don't accept it in our life either. That's why God the Father sent His Son Jesus Christ to cleanse us of our sins. Hopefully we can look within ourselves and see the areas where overcoming and change still need to take place. Paul tells us that after we examine ourselves, this is how we are to keep the spring feast days. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 8. And I'd like to read this to you from the New Living Translation. 1 Corinthians 5, verse 8. Paul says, so let us celebrate the festival, not with the old bread of wickedness and evil, but with the new bread of sincerity and truth. The old bread of wickedness and evil is a reflection of the way we used to live our life. When we keep this festival that Paul's talking about here, which is a focus and a point towards the spring holy days, we're to keep it with the new bread that comes from Jesus Christ and His sacrifice, that bread we partake of at Passover, that needs to rule in our life. And it needs to be one of sincerity and truth. When we look and examine our life, that's the question we need to ask ourselves. Am I sincere, a sincere Christian? And is God's truth working in my life? Am I living within the truth? We can look like we are, we can sound like we are, but God and Jesus Christ know for a fact if we are. And if we look and are honest with ourselves, we know whether we are or not. But our examination shouldn't be all negative, not by any stretch. Hopefully, our examination will be positive as well. You know, the Coca-Cola, I remember growing up as a kid or maybe an older teenager, I might remember they used to have a slogan, and they used to have commercials, and it said that they were the real thing, that Coke was the real thing. And I'm sure that was a comparison to their competitor of Pepsi. But Cope used to brag and say they are the real thing. Well, how do we know that we're the real thing? If we look at ourselves and we ask ourselves in our examination and say, am I the real thing? Am I a real Christian? Well, you'll know if you look at yourself and you see that you are focused on changing, not just now as we enter Passover, but throughout your life. Are you focused on changing? Are you focused on finding sins and overcoming them? Do you live your life trying to be as forgiving to others as you can? If you are, that's a good sign. That's a sign that you're walking in the way of Jesus Christ. If you look at your life and you compare yourself to Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 and 23, the fruits of God's Holy Spirit, if you see His fruit bearing out and coming out in your life to one degree or another, that's a good thing. That's the kind of examination that we want to do. You want to see that the fruit of God's Spirit working and coming out of you towards others in your life. Now is the time for us to be our own personal dokimizo, to check for our authenticity in our Christian life, in our Christian walk. The second area for today's sermon that we need to focus on as we get closer to Passover and the spring holidays is we need to be granting forgiveness. We need to be granting forgiveness. As we go through our life, there's a lot of bad things that happen to us. Things that shouldn't happen to us. Things that are not fair. And also, we do more than our share of bad things to others. As we enter the spring feast days, we should give some thought to our relationship with others. Really think about your relationship with others. Maybe during this past year you've suffered through some type of hurt, emotional hurt, by someone else. Maybe it was a family member. Maybe it was a spouse. Maybe it was a coworker. Maybe it was a spiritual brother or sister that caused an offense, or that you took an offense by something that they said or did. It doesn't really matter who it was, but what does matter is what you did with that hurt. What did you do once you felt that emotional hurt? Because when you feel that, you do something with it. That's the natural human tendency. You do something with a hurt when you feel it. We need to ask ourselves, have we constructed a wall between that other person and ourselves? Have we shunned them, decided, well, I'm just not going to talk to that person anymore because he or she hurt me? Have we talked poorly about them to others, trying to cause them harm and hurt, putting them down? Do we despise that person that brought us hurt, that caused the offense? And even worse, what Jesus Christ warned us about is, have you even allowed hatred to come into your heart because of that hurt, because of that offense? We don't want to be too quick to just answer no. These are some of the hard questions we need to ask ourselves as we're heading towards Passover. It's part of that examination process. Did we do those things, or did we do some opposite things, like going to God and praying for that person? And praying for that person doesn't mean, God, go get him. That's not the kind of prayer we want to offer to those that caused us hurt. But we need to offer prayers of spiritual blessings, asking God to bless that person spiritually. Prayers asking God to work even stronger in their life and help them to produce even more growth in their life. Pray for yourself, that God grant you compassion, mercy, and forgiveness. That's so important. And then put that motivation, those prayers, to work in your life and go out and show kindness, show love to them. Put away the bad feelings. Do just the opposite of building walls and tear them down. We must always remember when we see the problems of others and their weaknesses, and we all have them, and from time to time we're going to see other people's problems and their weaknesses, and in some cases even their sins. We need to remember it's not our job to fix them. It's God's job. God is working with them in their life. God is working with me in my life. And His hands are full with me. They really are. But we need to always remember and keep our focus that it's not my job to correct or to get involved and change another person. That doesn't mean you don't reach out in love and concern to offer help. We should, as brothers and sisters. But there's a line there between reaching out and offering help and to being there for somebody when they have a sin, as opposed to jumping in there and saying, I need to go and correct that person. There's a line there. It's God's job to correct, not our job. Matthew chapter 6, verse 12. A few weeks ago, we looked at the model prayer, and I'd like to go back to it today as well. There's a lot of good information for us in the model prayer that Jesus Christ gave us on how to pray to His Father. Matthew chapter 6. I just want to look at verse 12. There's a powerful statement here in this model prayer that we're to offer to God. Verse 12 of Matthew 6. I want to read it from the New Living Translation as well. It says, and forgive us our sins. That's our prayer to God. Go to God in prayer and say, Father, please forgive me for my sins. But then Jesus Christ puts a disclaimer on there, and He says, as I have forgiven them who have sinned against me. That's a disclaimer by Jesus Christ and God the Father saying that if you want your sins forgiven, you better be a forgiver. I think each and every one of us here in this room desire greatly to have our sins forgiven. When we go before our Father and we kneel down before Him any day of the year and ask for forgiveness, we hope and desperately hope that Jesus Christ's sacrifice will be applied to our life. Well, Jesus Christ is saying if you really hope for that and you really desire to have your sins forgiven and be washed and cleansed, you need to be forgiving of others. And that's tough for us because we're not Jesus Christ and we're not God the Father. It's very easy for us to hold on to hurts and not to put them away. How quickly and how deeply have we forgiven others? When I ask that in a different way towards myself, and I ask myself, how quickly and how deeply do I hope that God the Father has forgiven me of my sins? I have a pretty quick answer. I hope it's very quick and very deep forgiveness, very thorough forgiveness. And I think all of us want that same thing. We need to make sure that that is our focus when hurts come our way. When offenses come our way, we need to quickly forgive them. Deeply forgive them. In prayer, thoughtful prayer to our Father in heaven, asking us to allow His Spirit to give us the ability to forgive. It's not an easy thing for a human to forgive another human. It's not easy. We need God's help. We need God's Holy Spirit working powerfully in our mind to help us, because hurts can be ingrained in our mind. And even though we go and we pray and we say, yes, Father, forgive them for what they did to me, and then a week, a month, a year later, we're still spreading that hurt around to other people. You won't believe what this doctor did to me. You won't believe what this teacher did to me. That's not forgiveness. We need to let it go. We need to let all hurts go. What did Jesus Christ do when He was hanging on the cross with just seconds left before He died? Being spit upon and mocked and beaten. and never did a thing wrong, didn't deserve anything. And what did he do? He said, Father, forgive them. Jesus Christ made them innocent in his mind. He made them innocent in his mind. That's what we need to do. When we know that we've been hurt and hurt has come upon us, we need to go before God the Father and ask God to help me to make them innocent. For, not just say forgive them for their sins, but help me to make them innocent in my mind. That needs to be our focus. And you might say, well, but they were guilty. It doesn't matter. Who's the justifier? Us or God the Father? God the Father is the justifier. Him and Jesus Christ will bring justice when it's there. But Jesus Christ asked for complete forgiveness for those people that did what they did to him. He said they do not understand what they are doing. He made them innocent in his mind. He forgave them and he was asking his Father to forgive them. Stephen was martyred, stoned to death. What was his last thought and prayer as rocks were coming flying at him at full speed right before he gave up his life? He prayed to the Father and he said, forgive them for what they are doing. He made them innocent. Were they innocent? No. Very guilty of what they were doing. That doesn't matter. What matters is what's going on in your mind and your heart and being a forgiving person. And that's what forgiveness is all about. It's about making that person innocent. That's what God and Jesus Christ do for us. When we say, Father, forgive me, God the Father says, yes, through my Son, Jesus Christ, you are made innocent. That needs to be our focus as we approach Passover. We don't go to Passover to have our sins forgiven. We can go before God the Father and Jesus Christ any moment of any day if we've been baptized and ask for God's forgiveness of our sins. We go to Passover to remember what we put Jesus Christ through because of our sins. It's a memorial of what Jesus Christ went through. It's a sobering time for the people of God. A very solemn service. And it's also a time when we remember our own personal commitment that we made to God and to Jesus Christ at baptism. But if you've been baptized and you have God's Holy Spirit dwelling in you, any moment, at any day, at any hour, at any time in your life, you can pray and ask God for forgiveness of any sin that you commit. That's what we have been given through Jesus Christ's sacrifice. But Jesus makes it very clear that it is critical that we forgive others of their sins. Matthew chapter 18, verse 21. The message about being forgiven is throughout the New Testament. And it's so important that we have and understand completely the importance of being a forgiving person towards our brother and sister. Matthew 18, verse 21, then Peter came to him and said, Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Up to seven times? Peter no doubt was thinking he was being pretty generous here. Should I forgive him seven times? And Jesus said to him, I do not say to you up to seven times, but up to 70 times seven. And Jesus Christ really isn't putting a number on it here, but he's trying to say endlessly. There's no limit on how much we hope that God and Jesus Christ will forgive us. I know I've sinned way more times than 770 or 7 times 70. Way more times than that to God the Father. And I have full faith and trust that his forgiveness continues to come to me. And I'm thankful that there's no limit. But that same no limit agreement applies to us in regards to our brother and our sister. Lost my place here just for a second. I'll be back on it here. Verse 23, therefore the kingdom of heaven is like a certain king who wanted to settle accounts with his servant. And when he had begun to settle the accounts, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. And I looked up that amount there, 10,000 talents, they said was equal to all of the currency that was brought into the British kingdom. It was an unfathomable amount of money, a lot of money. But as he was not able to pay, that's the whole point there, is that the debt was so great that it was impossible to pay it back. Which, of course, compares us in our debt to God and Jesus Christ. It cannot be paid back by us. Verse 25, but as he was not able to pay, his master commanded that he be sold with his wife and children and all that he had, and that the payment be made. So they were to sell everything they had and they were to go into slavery. Verse 26, the servant therefore fell down before him, saying, Master, have patience with me, and I will pay you all. Then the master of the servant was moved with compassion and released him and forgave him the debt. That's a lot of forgiveness. Verse 28, but that servant went out and found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii, and he laid hands on him and took him by the throat, saying, pay me what you owe me. Now, if we see the context of what's being played out here, it's a physical example, but it's full of spiritual meat, spiritual understanding, a spiritual example. Our debt with God and Jesus Christ is a debt that we of ourselves cannot ever pay back. Impossible. And upon compassion, as we pray out and cry out to God, He grants us forgiveness. But if we go and turn to our brother and our sister who owes us just a small, minor debt compared to what we owe God and Jesus Christ, are we grabbing our brother and sister by the neck and saying, you did me wrong? And I'm not talking about just spiritual brother and sister. This whole world is our brother and sister. Anyone. Pick it up again in verse 28. But this servant went out and found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii, and he laid hands on him and took him by the throat, saying, pay me what you owe. So his fellow servant fell down at his feet and begged him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay you all. And he would not, but went and threw him into prison till he should pay the debt. So when his fellow servants saw that what he had done, they were very grieved and came and told their master all that he had done. Then his master, after he had called him, said to him, you wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you begged me. Should you not also have had compassion on your fellow servant, just as I had pity on you? See, he's talking about our relationship with our brother, with our sister. Verse 34, and his master was angry and delivered him to the torturers until he should pay all that was due to him. Verse 35, Jesus Christ wraps it all up here. He says, so my heavenly Father also will do to you if each of you from his heart does not forgive his brother his trespasses. Powerful message from Jesus Christ. He doesn't hold back in painting us the example of how important it is that we be forgiving towards one another. Forgiving to the point to where you come in your mind to making that person innocent. And like I said, it's not an easy task. It requires a lot of prayer, a lot of study, and maybe even, depending on what that trespass was, maybe even fasting and drawing even closer to God to get that kind of forgiveness in your mind and your heart towards others. Our sins have placed us as debtors in the hand of a creditor. Have you ever fallen behind in a debt, in a bill? I have, especially when I was younger. There were times where I couldn't pay a bill, and the longer it goes, the more vicious that creditor becomes. They'll call you, they'll hound you, they'll be on you, they'll send you threatening letters, and eventually they can even contact your employer. It can really ruin your life. We are in debt to God and to Jesus Christ. But thankfully, they're merciful. They're kind. They're forgiving of our debt to them. We need to be the same way towards one another. To God, we are debtors because of our sins. And what is the debt and what is due to pay that debt to God and to Jesus Christ. What is due? Our eternal life is due. Because of our sins, God says you've sinned even one time, your sin brings upon you death. And it's not talking about a physical death. Romans 6:23, you can put it in your notes for the sake of time, we'll just refer to it, but it says, for the wages of sin is death. One sin brings upon us eternal death. We might say, boy, that's kind of harsh, not fair. But if we have that thought, it's because we don't really properly understand the true righteousness of God and Jesus Christ and how they will not accept sin. They will not accept sin. Ezekiel chapter 18, verse 20. Also for your notes, Ezekiel 18, verse 20 says very clearly, the soul that sins shall die. The soul that sins shall die. There is nothing that we can do to repay or compensate God for even one sin that we've committed. That's hard to imagine. One sin. What if in my life, and this is not anywhere near truth, what if in my life I only had one sin? You think, well, I should be able to make that up to God. Nope, can't do it. Impossible. Can't possibly do it. Until our spiritual debt is forgiven at baptism, we have no hope of eternal life. And that eternal debt is on our heels, hounding us every day, just like a creditor. Back to Matthew chapter 6, back to the end of the model prayer. Matthew chapter 6, verse 14. Jesus Christ is wrapping up the model prayer. And I find it interesting as he wraps it up, he reemphasizes this point of being forgiving. Verse 14, for if you forgive men their trespasses, their sins against you is what it's talking about, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. Again, it's a prerequisite for having your sins forgiven. You want your sins forgiven? Be forgiving. That's what Jesus Christ is saying. Verse 15, but if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. He can't say it enough. He wants us to make sure we have it in our minds and in our hearts, the importance of being forgiving towards others. It's got to be there. It's so important. The third focus as we head into Passover is have faith in Jesus Christ. Have faith in Jesus Christ. All of God's feast days, as we know, point to one aspect or another of His tremendous plan of salvation for you and for all of mankind. That's what the feast days point to. We've heard that taught endlessly within God's church, that beginning with the spring holy days, going through the fall holy days, all of those holy days point to the salvation plan of God for mankind. The spring feast days are no different. They start off focusing about the need of God's plan of salvation for you and I, for all of mankind. They're centered on the first part of God's plan for salvation for you and I, and that is to restore your relationship with God the Father. That's what the spring holy days are all about. That's the beginning of salvation, the plan of salvation. You can't have a hope of salvation unless your relationship with God and Jesus Christ has been restored because it's broken because of your sins. So the plan of salvation for all of mankind and for us today begins with us having a restoration in the relationship between us and Jesus Christ. We have no hope of salvation without being made clean before God. That process has been made complete through the life and death of Jesus Christ. And we have a role in that process. It's just not God. It's just not Jesus Christ. We have our role in the plan of salvation for us. We must believe. That is our role. As Christians, we must have faith. We must have faith in the saving sacrifice of Jesus Christ. If I sit up here and I think about my own personal sins And I think about all the pain and the suffering for myself and for others that I brought onto myself because of my sins. It would be overwhelming. And I would sit there and be so down and depressed with my own sins that I would think, I have no hope of salvation. But that's not taking into account the other half of the story. The most important half of the story, which is the power of Jesus Christ's sacrifice for you and me. Through that sacrifice, God and Jesus Christ offer us a cleansing completely of all sin in our life. That's another very difficult thing to fully grasp and to hold on to in our minds and our lives. To give our conscience a complete rest, so to speak. We must forgive others, as we've seen. But have you fully accepted God's forgiveness of your sins? Have you? We need to ask ourselves that as we examine ourselves and as we head into Passover. Have I fully accepted the sacrifice of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of my sins? If you have, you feel confident. You feel bold in a right and respectful way towards God and Jesus Christ. Not because we've done it, but because Jesus Christ has done that for you. As Christians, true Christians, you don't sit there in self-pity and beating yourself up because of your sins, because Jesus Christ forgave them all. We can't hold on to them when they've been washed from us. And they are washed from us every time we go to them and ask for forgiveness. Our conscience is a powerful force in our life, and that is good. God intended it to be that way. But our conscience likes to focus on the physical things in life. When we do wrong, it tells us. But it also tells us when we do things that are right. Like if you're holding a door for someone, you go into a restaurant or a store, you happen to glance behind you, you see an elderly lady or any lady coming up to the door, and you say, oh, well, let me hold the door for you. And she walks through and she thanks you, and you get them. You think, that was a nice thing I did there for that lady. That's your conscience talking to you. You feel good about it. Your conscience says, that's a good thing that you did. And that's a good thing to feel good about yourself. But understand that that's your conscience working towards you. Sometimes we can, as Christians, can even sit back and say, well, I keep the Sabbath, I tithe, I don't eat pork. But those things are physical things as well. They aren't doing anything to take care of the spiritual problem we have of sin. God, through Jesus Christ, washed our conscience of feeling guilty from this day forward once we have been granted forgiveness. He completely cleansed our conscience. Turn to Mark chapter 10. Mark chapter 10, verse 17. Mark chapter 10, verse 17 says, now as he was going out on the road, one came running, knelt down before him, and asked him, good teacher, what shall I do that I may inherit eternal life? So Jesus said to him, why do you call me good? No one is good but one, that is God. You know the commandments. Do not commit adultery. Do not murder. Do not steal. Do not bear false witness. Do not defraud. Honor your father and your mother. And he answered and said to him, teacher, all these things I have kept from my youth. Then Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said to him, one thing you lack. Go your way and sell whatever you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And come and take up the cross and follow me. Jesus Christ is telling him that you need to be willing to give everything in your life to have a relationship with me and my Father. Be willing to sacrifice everything. Hold nothing back. That man had good deeds. He kept the Sabbath, obeyed the laws. Christ knew that. He didn't dispute it. He didn't say, no, you're a sinner. He knew that he obeyed God's laws. But he also knew that that person still wasn't getting it. That it's not just about obedience to his laws. It's about what's going on in your heart and what you're holding back in your relationship with God and Jesus Christ. It goes deeper than just our physical obedience to God's law. That man ended up walking away, discouraged and depressed. The same message and the same question is to all of us and even to our youth who have observed these things from their earliest days. Are we willing to give everything to follow Jesus Christ and God the Father? Hebrews chapter 9, verse 7. Let's turn there. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 7. Here it talks about the Old Covenant principle of how the Israelites used to offer the sacrifices for their physical cleansing, because it didn't do anything for them spiritually. Hebrews chapter 9, we'll read verses 7 through 10. But into the second part, the high priest went alone once a year, not without blood, which he offered for himself and for the people's sins committed in ignorance. And it's talking about that day of atonement when the high priest would go into the holiest of holy, in there before God, and bring the sins of all the people before God the Father with blood. Verse 8, the Holy Spirit indicating this, that the way into the holiest of all was not yet made manifest while the first tabernacle was still standing. In other words, it was just what they were doing was just a physical symbol. It wasn't the reality of what was needed to be done. It was just a physical symbol. Verse 9, it says it was symbolic for the present time, for that time, before Jesus Christ came and lived his life on this earth and died. It was symbolic for the present time in which both gifts and sacrifices are offered, which cannot make him who performed the service perfect in regard to their conscience. In other words, they still lived within their sins. It was still on their minds and in their hearts. There was no forgiveness granted, no cleansing of that person. Verse 10, concerned only with foods and drinks, various washings, and fleshly ordinances imposed until the time of Reformation, which is until the time when things would be changed and reality would hit, which is Jesus Christ. The important lesson when you read this is to understand and always understand that physical things can never compensate God and Jesus Christ for a spiritual problem or spiritual sins or our sins. Nothing we can do physically can ever compensate God to have our sins forgiven. We can't do it. It requires Jesus Christ. It requires faith in the power of His sacrifice for us. The animal sacrifices were not able to remove the guilt within a person's conscience. They still walked around with it, knowing what they had done, knowing that that penalty of death was still there in front of them. But through Jesus Christ, we have forgiveness. We have the complete cleansing of our conscience, the complete cleansing of our filthy, sinful life. Let's go on and read verse 11 through 14. It says, but Christ came as a high priest of the good things to come. See, it pictured what was to come in the future. With a greater, more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, in other words, not with anything physical, that is, not of this creation, not with the blood of goats and calves, but with his own blood, he entered the most holy place, once and for all, having obtained eternal redemption. For if the blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of a heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctifies for the purifying of the flesh, that's all it did was purify their flesh, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, in other words, the perfect, real perfect sacrifice, how much more shall it cleanse your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? We need to live in verse 14 every day of our life, knowing and being reassured and having full faith, full assurance that our sins have been paid for and that we have been washed clean. That's reasons to celebrate on our knees before God and Jesus Christ as we enter the Passover season. Go to God and give thanks for that. Tell Him how much you appreciate the sacrifice that He gave of His Son. Hebrews chapter 10, beginning in verse 1. For the law, in other words, it's talking about the sacrificial law, having a shadow again of the good things to come, and not the very image of the things. In other words, it's not exactly like what was going to be coming, because it wasn't with animals, it was with Jesus Christ. Can never with these same sacrifices which they offer continually, year by year, make those who approach perfect. They couldn't do it. Couldn't make them perfect. But for then would they have not been ceased to be offered. For the worshippers once purified would have had no more conscience of sins. And we have been purified, and we should not have a conscience or a constant worry of sin bringing death upon us in our life. Verse 3, but in those sacrifices there is a reminder of sins every year. Every year they were reminded of their sins. For it is not possible for the blood of bulls and goats could take away sins. Therefore, when He came into the world, He said, sacrifice and offering you did not desire, but a body you have prepared for Me. In burnt offerings and sacrifices for sins you had no pleasure. Then I said, behold, I have come. In the volume of the book it is written of Me to do Your will, O God. Previously saying, sacrifice and offerings, burnt offerings and offerings for sin you did not desire, nor had pleasure in them, which are offered according to the law. And then He said, verse 9, behold, I have come to do Your will, O God. He takes away the first, that He may establish the second. He took away the symbolic first to bring in the reality of real forgiveness, of real cleansing, a cleansing of our conscience, a removing of guilt from our minds by the second. Verse 10, by that will we have been sanctified. That means cleansed, sanctified, through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once and for all. That's why we don't go to Passover every year needing our sins forgiven. Because Jesus Christ did it once for everyone. And it's applied to us now if we've been baptized. It's applied to us at baptism. The world's sins, they're still in them until they go through that cleansing process at baptism. But Jesus Christ, as it says there, did it for everyone, for all of mankind. We receive this cleansing by our faith in Jesus Christ. You have to believe. You have to have faith in it completely. Cleansing sacrificed by Jesus Christ from God the Father. Real quickly, 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7. Very important verse here. 1 Corinthians 5, verse 7, because it describes you and I. From the Apostle Paul. 1 Corinthians 5, verse 7. Paul says, therefore, purge out the old leaven. That's the sin that's in your life. Sin that's been hanging on there for some time. Purge out the old leaven, that you may be a new lump, since you truly are unleavened. What does that mean? With our understanding and knowledge of the meaning of the days of unleavened bread, which leaven pictures sin, you put it out of your life, you're putting sin out of your life, therefore that leaves you sinless. Paul says that you are without sin. You've been cleansed. You are unleavened. That's what he means when he says unleavened. It means you are without sin. You can't be with sin and still be leavened. Or unleavened, considered unleavened. Let's read verse 7 again. Therefore, purge out the old leaven, that you may be a new lump, since you truly are unleavened. And that means keep your focus on keeping sin and leaven out of your life, because you are unleavened. For indeed, Christ, our Passover, was sacrificed for us. That's why we work to put sin out and to keep sin out. The days of unleavened bread picture all of that symbology for us. Our righteousness comes from Jesus Christ, from His cleansing. It's not from our obedience, not from our physical well-doing, so to speak. It's all about Jesus Christ. It's not about our good deeds. Two verses left. Philippians chapter 3, verse 8. Philippians chapter 3, verse 8. Paul says that here that we obtain righteousness from God. When you don't have sin in your life, when you've been made sinless or unleavened, then there is righteousness there. That's what the definition of righteousness is. It means without sin. Philippians chapter 3, verse 8 says, "Yet indeed I also count all things lost for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord." He's just saying that nothing else has any value except for his relationship with God and Jesus Christ in his life. "For whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish that I may gain Christ." Verse 9, "and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is from the law," and Paul was obedient to the law, but he knew that his righteousness didn't come from it. "And I be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which is from God by faith." That's our role. Our righteousness comes from God to us through Jesus Christ by faith, by belief. Verse 10, "that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death." And we were conformed to his death at Passover. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 18. At the beginning of the sermon, I referred to how the feast days all picture God's plan of salvation. They all lead us. God's plan of salvation leads us. God's feast days lead us to understanding the plan of salvation. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 18. And I mentioned how these spring holy days are all about the first part of God's plan of salvation, which is restoring our relationship with God. That's what this is all about. Passover, Christ's sacrifice, removing sin, being unleavened, unleavening our homes, is all about restoring our relationship with God and with Jesus Christ. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 18. "For Christ also suffered once for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God." Do you see that? That's what it's all about. The whole point of him dying and giving his life in death to us, shedding his blood, having his body beaten, was to bring us to God. We cannot forget that. That's the whole point about Passover. It's the whole point about the plan of salvation, that we have to be brought before God. "That he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive by the Spirit." We're put to death in the flesh because of our sins. We went in baptism, when we went into that watery grave, we took our sins with us, just as Christ did into his grave. And when he was resurrected out of it, there was life given to him, eternal life. When we come up out of that water, we're cleansed, completely cleansed of our sins, and face a new life, a very positive life, having all of our past sins gone and removed from us. Our conscience completely cleared. No worry of eternal death anymore. That's God's plan of salvation. That's what it's all about bringing us to God by the way of Jesus Christ. It sums up the whole intent for the spring holy day season. So in closing, I would encourage you to take these days before the spring holy day season and give them full contemplation. Really focus on these core areas of your relationship with God. Examine yourself. If you haven't forgiven everyone, forgive them in your mind. Make them innocent. And then also think about what Jesus Christ has done for you. And live and believe and have faith in what he's done for you. I hope you have a great rest of the Sabbath day. (Clears throat)